So let's say you have an OS install on one hard drive and you want to copy it to another. Or maybe you have a physical computer and you want to convert it to a virtual machine. Well, there's lots of ways to get this done. And my favorite way is Clonezilla. Greetings and welcome to another Clonetastic episode of Veronica Explains. I'm Veronica, and today I'm going to talk about Clonezilla, an awesome open source tool which can directly clone drives, as well as clone them over the network and to disk images. If you just want to get a step-by-step guide, there's timestamps in this video, and I've also posted a more verbose tutorial on my website, vkc.sh. Clonezilla can be thought of as a collection of programs which facilitate the cloning, imaging, and restoration of disks. And while it's technically possible to install Clonezilla as a typical application, you're probably more likely to use it via a live USB, so that's what I'm going to cover today. For more advanced uses, the team behind Clonezilla also offers two server editions, which allow for enterprise-friendly imaging features. But that's so far beyond the scope of an introductory video that I'm going to skip the socially manipulative part where I ask you to leave me a comment if you want to see it. Clonezilla can work directly device to device, as in copy this disk drive onto another physical drive, or it can work with disk images. A disk image is a point-in-time representation of the layout of a disk, and can often take up less space than a full disk, so images are well-suited for backups. I used Clonezilla on the job to take snapshots of work laptops before sending them into the field, knowing that the employees using them might lose or misplace their gear. And in those cases, Clonezilla was life-saving technology, as I was able to redeploy all of their precious software to a cold spare in an hour or two. Another way I used Clonezilla was to convert industrial field devices running Windows 7 into virtual machines at end of life, so that way I could maintain an offline copy of a working reference configuration. Like I said, life-saving technology. Clonezilla was created by Stephen Hsiao, sorry if I mispronounced your name, of the National Center for High Performance Computing in Taiwan. Thanks, Stephen. The team maintains a great website filled with docs, including clear step-by-step instructions, over at clonezilla.org. And in my experience, Clonezilla works with virtually any x86-based machine from the last 20 years. And yes, that includes 32-bit systems, virtual machines, and even Intel Macs. ARM isn't quite there yet, at least not officially as far as I can tell. But they might be working on it, and if that's the case, I'll pin a comment or write a blog post or whatever. With all of that out of the way, let's get started with Clonezilla. First, you'll need a USB stick of some kind for flashing the Clonezilla ISO. Clonezilla doesn't take up all that much room, so you can probably get away with anything over a gig. And yes, I've read reports that it appears to work with Ventoy. I mean, I haven't tried it, but I'm sure people in the comments have. I'm old school, so I just download the stable ISO and then I flash it like any other Linux distro. And if ISO flashing is new to you, I did do a video about it, but I'll also outline more of this process on my website. Then, if you're copying a disk to a Clonezilla image, which is what I'm doing in today's episode, you'll need a drive to store the image. Now, I think it makes life easier to use a larger drive than the source disk, but oftentimes these images are actually pretty small, so that isn't exactly a strict requirement. If you're cloning a disk to another disk, or restoring a Clonezilla image, then you have to make sure that the destination disk is equal to or larger than the source disk. Clonezilla is not able to break physics and shrink your storage. The destination disk can also be network storage, so if you have a NAS and can spin up a Samba or S3 share, or even just SSH, that might be the best option for you. So here I have a stack of little mini PCs that I rescued from e-waste recently. One of them is running Linux Mint, and I'll walk you through how I created an image of the installation using Clonezilla and then converted it to this VM running on my desktop. And even though I'm cloning a Linux machine in this tutorial, you can also use Clonezilla to clone a Windows machine if that's the kind of thing you're into. My USB stick for booting Clonezilla is this thing, and the destination disk is this external SSD with 2 terabytes of space on board. The external SSD has a folder inside called Clonezilla Images, but you don't necessarily need that. I just think it makes it neater. You boot Clonezilla just like you boot any other Linux Live USB. You restart your computer and you mash whatever key is necessary in order to bring up a boot menu. Then you select the Clonezilla flash drive and it'll start booting right up. You select a language, then a keyboard layout, and then after a moment or so, you can start Clonezilla, then choose a mode of operation. Device-to-image saves disk images, which are often smaller than full-size disks and can be restored multiple times with ease. And for most backup uses, this is probably the option to select. It's the mode I use most often, and the one I'm doing in today's tutorial. Device-to-device clones the contents and layout of one drive to another. That's great if all you're doing is migrating to a new storage device. The remote options allow you to run Clonezilla on 2 machines connected over a network, and clone one to another. Keep in mind that device-to-device cloning requires destination storage that's equal to or larger than the source drive. Images, on the other hand, can be smaller because empty space isn't stored. Just remember that when you restore that image, you'll need a drive equal to or larger than the source material. The server options are more advanced, enterprise-oriented solutions, which I promise I won't pester you about in this video. For our purposes, I'm going to choose device to image as I want to save a disk image of this Linux Mint install to my external SSD. This offers a ton of flexibility as I can easily redeploy it on this machine, on another machine, on a VM, pretty much anywhere. After choosing device to image mode, you have to choose where it's going to save the image. And in my case, it's the external SSD. But it's super flexible. Here you can specify a local drive or all manner of network locations. Perfect for hosting images in an offsite backup solution. As always, just make sure to test those backups before you rely on them. When you select the local device option, it'll prompt you to insert the drive and wait a moment for it to be recognized before continuing. Here, I'll plug in the drive and then hit enter, and I can see 3 disks, the source NVMe, which is installed in the computer, the Clonezilla USB stick, and the 2 terabyte SSD. This screen provides a good sanity check because if for whatever reason your source drive isn't available, it's probably better to find out here early on in the process. In my case, it's all there as expected, so I'm going to press Ctrl+C to clear the window. It'll take a minute to scan all of the connected drives, and then you get to choose a device to mount as the image repository. That's the destination drive, and in my case, it's the SSD partition at SDB1. Now, after selecting that, it gives you an option to check and repair the file system for the image repository. And I can skip this part because I'm quite confident the SSD's partition is in good working order. Then you get to choose a folder on the destination drive, and in my case, it's that Clonezilla-images directory I mentioned earlier. Here I can see the current selected directory name changed to the folder we created earlier, so now I can tab over to Done to move on to the next part. Clonezilla will show some details about that directory, and then you can press Enter to mount everything and get to the wizard page. Now, I typically use the beginner wizard because the defaults here are probably suitable for most folks' needs. Next, you choose if you're saving a whole disk or just individual partitions. Now, saving individual partitions is a bit of an advanced thing, and I'm just interested in whole disk cloning right now. So we'll select Save Disk. Now we can name the disk image, and it defaults to using the current date as the name. I usually add something a bit descriptive here. After that, we choose the source disk, and in our case, it's the NVMe inside the desktop, which is selected by default. Then you can choose a compression option, and generally speaking, it's probably best to stick with the default here. In fact, it helpfully warns you not to change anything if you don't know what you're doing. Next, it gives you the option to check and repair the file system before saving it. Now, I typically skip this, but if you're trying to image a borked install, you might want to interactively check and repair. After that, it'll ask you if you want to check if the image is restorable, and I typically check because it really doesn't take long. It'll then ask if you want to encrypt the image. Clonezilla uses EcryptFS to encrypt images with a passphrase, and I typically use this feature with enterprise backups. For now, I'm just going to skip it. Then, to wrap up the wizard, it'll ask what action to perform when everything finishes up. By default, it'll prompt you at the end of the process to choose to reboot or shut down, and that's what I'm doing here. It'll let you know what the long-form command would look like to rerun this exact setup again, which could be useful if you're going to roll a custom imaging solution using Clonezilla. Then, it starts collecting info on the drive before giving you a final "Are you ready?" option. Hitting Y, then pressing Enter, begins the process of imaging the drive. This can take some amount of time, depending on what kind of drive or machine you're using. It can also vary based on how much data you have to image. The screen's gonna flash for a bit while it's swapping partitions, making an image, and then checking everything, but after a few minutes, it'll let you know if it was successful or if an error happened. Then you can simply press Enter and shut down or restart the machine. Now that I've imaged the disk from this desktop, I can clone it to a totally different machine, or even a VM like I did over here. You'll need to make sure that the destination disk is larger than the source disk, because again, Clonezilla can't break physics, and shrinking partitions for reducing storage is well outside the scope of this video. Cloning this image to a new physical machine starts out just like we did before. Plug in the Clonezilla flash drive, turn on the machine, and boot from the flash drive just like any other distro. In my case, I'm cloning to a virtual machine, so I start the VM with the Clonezilla ISO mounted and a virtual disk that's larger than the source. Then I select the same options as last time: language, keyboard, local device, plug in the drive containing the image, and select the drive. In my case, I'm going to skip the checks and then select the image directory. Note that you shouldn't navigate into the subdirectory containing the actual image. Clonezilla is not going to know what to do with that subdirectory. So once you see the image in the folder, tab over to Done. Then press Enter to mount the image directory. After a while, the beginner wizard's going to pop up, just like it did when we were writing the image. And this is going to behave pretty much just like it did before. Of course, instead of saving a disk, we're restoring a disk. Then we select the disk and walk through the prompts just like before. We pick the target drive, which is going to be wiped completely and replaced with the contents of the image. We keep walking through the prompts, and it'll check if the image can be restored and alert you if there are issues. Here, I've got an alert about a possible fstab issue, not fstab, because I'm going from an NVMe to a VM. /etc/fstab issues should be pretty easy to fix, though, so I'm going to move on. It'll ask twice if I'm sure that I'm sure that we want to write over the disk, and then it's off to the races. While it's restoring, Clonezilla recognizes that it's working with a Linux system, so it cheroots and adjusts some grub stuff to make sure that the system's bootable. Nice. After it's complete, I can restart the machine, and in my case, it's a virtual machine rendition of the real live desktop computer that I was just using. It's kind of like magic. It's probably easier than installing Windows. And as I've mentioned a bunch in this video, Clonezilla is a super flexible program. It'll even handle encrypted drives. My old Chromebook running Fedora's Sway Spin is all luxed up, but Clonezilla was able to make a copy of it without problems, and I was able to easily restore it to a virtual machine before donating it to Free Geek Twin Cities. I've also had luck backing up and restoring BitLockered Windows devices. But encrypted devices might use a direct copy mode, which can take up a lot more room for the image. So again, just make sure that you have plenty of space on that image drive. Clonezilla really is a fantastic tool for imaging, duplicating, and restoring disks. And we are so lucky to have such a wonderful tool freely available here in our Linux ecosystem for anyone to use. But that shouldn't surprise any of us, because Linux is awesome. And so are you. Did I even do any engagement farming in this video? I must be off today.